I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down flights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Chases me down flights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. All the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Welcome to worship. Great to have you as part of our online community today. If you've been with us for a number of months, great, delighted to have you back. If you're with us for the first time, maybe a friend or a neighbor sent the invitation to you to come and experience our worship at Incarnation, we're delighted that you could be here. We really hope that you get some sense today of how the Spirit of God continues to work within all of us to allow us to be more fully alive as we engage the community. We want to be a church without walls. And so great to have you here today. One quick announcement, and this announcement is for primarily the people who are connected with the Incarnation community. But if you're becoming more and more attached to the community just because of your connections online, you can also listen in carefully to this. We are making commitments for our upcoming ministry season for 2021, and you'll see a link to that with the posting today, so I won't go into a lot of details about it, but there's a couple ways that we want you to continue to commit to the life of this community. First is through prayer and encouragement. We all need one another these days, even as we are physically distant. Prayer is one of the ways that we can be with one another. And so we hope that you'll make a commitment to continue to pray for our community, to pray for one another, to pray for what's happening in the world. We're also going to be asking for financial commitments and commitments to serving. Again, you'll see those connected with the postings that come with our online worship link today. But it's a way for us to extend ourselves into the world. Incarnation believes fully that the Spirit of God continues to work in us, but it works through us so that this world can be better. There are many people who have responded to this so far, and our whole campaign is called I'm In. It's just an invitation for us to be in together as we make our common journey. And there are a number of people who have been willing to share a little bit of their story, and so we want you to hear one more again this morning.
My name is Georgia Schultz, and I'm in. That was a fantastic experience. And I have been in small groups and led small groups ever since then. because in a congregation, the size and the age range of incarnation, it's the way to know people's names and know them outside of just saying hi, hi on Sunday morning. For me, the reward has been years of being able to talk about my faith journey with kindred spirits who are also on theirs. We all may be at different places, but we're all striving toward what we think God wants us to do. And I'm not the kind of person that goes out and blats about my faith in every conversation out on the street. I'm not one of those people. And so for me, it's been an enriching experience of deepening my own connection to my faith tradition through talking about it with others and exploring it and even questioning it. Number one, it gives you good feeling because you are doing something outside of your own interests. And number two, it's fun. It's fun. Just stick your toe in and you'll find it's fun. It's great. And it's rewarding because as we offer ourselves, other people draw on that as strength. Even though we don't see it as towering strength, other people draw on it and say, oh, let's go with it. I could do that. And I think that that's what congregation, that's what the church is about, is being here to hold each other up and encourage each other to be the best person we can be. I am excited about the possibilities of all of us working to become more Christ-like in our interaction with people around us. I am in.
We open our worship service with these brief words of confession and reflection and renewal, and there'll be times when you'll have a chance to just pause in the moment of it and experience God's continued renewing healing through the power of forgiveness. We gather by the gracious invitation of our God, who created us in God's image, our Lord Jesus, who showed us how to love, and the Spirit that strengthens us for active service. Amen. As followers of Jesus, we have been invited to love our neighbor as Jesus first loved us. Join me in these words. Forgive us for not loving well, for holding on to resentment and hurt, for being divided by our fears and failures, for living primarily for ourselves and our own benefit rather than living for the sake of others. We invite you to pause for a moment of silent reflection and confession. Friends in Christ, by the power of Jesus' forgiving love, your sins are forgiven. Your lives are being made new. The world is being restored. Know this in the deepest parts of your being. Your life matters to God and to the neighbor. Fill us with your love, O God. Move us to be people who love. We sing together our opening song.
Costly wounds of love. Gospel, Luke chapter 12. Someone in this crowd says to Jesus,
"Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me."
But Jesus said to him,
"Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?"
Then Jesus said to the crowd,
"Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist of the abundance of possession."
Then Jesus told them a parable.
"A land of rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, 'What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops.
I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods.
And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him,
'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?'
So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich towards God."
The Gospel of our Lord.
Today, as we continue our You Matter series, our theme is Your Generosity Matters. So, of course, we're turning to Jesus' parable about the rich fool and the bigger barns. Wasn't it fun to have the Club 4-5 kids and their leaders tell the story for us today? I have a confession to make. I really see myself in this story. And no, I'm not the person asking for my brother to share the inheritance. No, I'm not the rich man who's super turned inward and celebrating his overabundance and unconcerned with the common good. No, I'm not God. I see myself as an outside observer who relishes the way that God calls out the rich man. I am right there just pointing a finger, judging the rich man. Yeah, you fool. No matter how many times I encounter this story, which has been a lot, I always seem to start in that place. And then I pause and I think a minute and I look at my life and I cringe a little. Wait, I am the rich man. Let me give you an example. Last winter before COVID, I was anticipating being at home more when my sabbatical started in the spring. And so I wanted to get organized. One space in particular that was a little out of hand was the kitchen. It seemed like it was always a challenge to put things away, and there wasn't a really good system that was clear for both me and my husband, especially regarding pots and pans and bakeware. So in the spirit of Marie Kondo, I decided to first take all of the things I baked with and all of the things I used in the oven out and put it all out and then pare it down to the pieces that I really loved and used frequently. So this is what came out of our cupboards and drawers. Feel free to judge me. I did. Then I took out all of our pots and pans. I took photos because it was such a moment of truth for me. And frankly, I felt foolish. How could I let it get so out of hand? I mean, no wonder it was hard to put things away. There was too much stuff, and it had become a burden. As I thought back to how I had accumulated so much, I don't think I was necessarily being greedy about pans and cookware. I mean, I think in my head, I was just preparing for whatever occasion might present itself. I value hospitality. I wanted to be ready. I like pretty things. They spark joy. But if I'm honest with myself, I simply wasn't paying attention. And if I'm really honest with myself, I was letting my aspirational self get the best of me. You know, that part of you that has a picture of what you would do and how you would be if you just had more time or the right supplies for your hobby or the right pans and bakeware to host a perfect dinner party, or whatever story your version of your aspirational self tells. It's that dream of our ideal self that we often compare ourselves to and then judge ourselves harshly when we fall short. When I think about this parable of the rich fool and the bigger barns, you know, most people I know aren't hoarding mountains of cash or things because they're all about me, me, me. I mean, more often, people are like me, right? They're just doing life. They're preoccupied with other things and not paying attention. Or they're trying to be responsible in saving for the future because they want to care for family or be prepared for whatever may happen. Or they're in a really tough season or have just come out of a really tough season. And so they're being super vigilant about every penny because they need to be. I mean, none of these things are really bad on their own. But what can happen is over time, we can get caught up in a story that narrows our view and turns our focus inward. And that narrative continues to shape our perspective and it becomes a cycle. What does Jesus say at the very start of this story, just before he launches into the parable? He says, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." I know I need to hear that again and again. Take care, be on your guard, pay attention, choose what is life-giving. You see, when we lift our heads from focusing on our own story, our own narrative, our perspective automatically shifts. Our view automatically expands. One way of expanding our perspective is by remembering who we are and whose we are. On the first week of this series, we started in Genesis chapter 1, where we heard, "You are made in the image of God." And that, combined with the promises at Jesus' baptism, "You are marked with God's love, pride of God's life," puts us right in the heart of God's story. Right from the beginning, God's story invites us to participate in something larger than ourselves. In Scripture, there's a word, shalom. Maybe you've heard it before. And the word shalom itself means well-being, wholeness, the perfection of God's creation, abundance, peace. And while the word shalom is not used in the first two chapters of Genesis, these chapters give us two of the most vivid pictures of shalom in Scripture. In Genesis chapters 1 and 2, we see one of the central concepts of shalom, that we are all connected, lived out. As Lisa Sharon Harper writes in her book, The Very Good Gospel, How Everything Wrong Can Be Made Right, she writes, "God created the world in a web of relationships that overflowed with forceful goodness. These relationships are far-reaching between humanity and God, between humanity and self, between genders, between humanity and the rest of creation, within families, between ethnic groups or races, and between nations. These relationships were very good in the beginning, and one word characterized them all, shalom." Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann describes it in this way. He writes, "The vision of wholeness, which is the supreme will of the biblical God, is the outgrowth of a covenant," so this communal relationship, "of shalom, in which persons are bound not only to God, but to one another in a caring, sharing, rejoicing community with none to make them afraid. We are not made for ourselves. We are made to live and to thrive as part of a community, a web of relationships where all can thrive. So here's a question for your reflection, for my reflection, for our reflection. As I consider how I am using my money and resources, here it is. Ask yourself this. Are my actions and ways of thinking right now drawing my perspective inward toward building bigger barns, or are they drawing me outward, expanding my vision, inviting me to participate in God's shalom, in the expansive love of Jesus at work in the world? It's so important for us to continually ask ourselves this question because there's so much at stake. Recently, there was an article in the Star Tribune that came from Bloomberg News. It's not surprising to learn that the effect of the pandemic recession has been to exacerbate the inequalities between the rich and poor. As this article reported, this Christmas will be one of exorbitant spending and lavish gifts for many American families. It will also be one of tight budgets and difficulty putting food on the table for many others. They went on to write, high-paid U.S. workers are benefiting from a strong stock market and lower expenses, allowing them to save more money than ever and spend more on holiday gifts. The less fortunate, meanwhile, are grappling with job losses, eviction, and food insecurity. Does this sound like shalom? Does this sound like God's desire for the web of creation and relationships that were created and called good? We may see this national article and see it as a far-off issue. But people in our larger community represent this full spectrum from poor to rich. People in our incarnation community represent the full spectrum from people to have extra and abundance to people who are grappling with job losses, housing, and food insecurity. As people of God, as a community who claims to follow Jesus and be shaped by his expansive love, we have a part to play in this reality. Does this feel daunting? Let me share a story with you. Christina Kuzmich is a blogger and a YouTube content creator. In 2017, she created a video that went viral called My Turning Point. In it, she shares her story of hitting rock bottom and what happened when she lifted her head and turned her perspective outward. This is her story. After her divorce, Christina Kuzmich found herself completely broke, as in sharing a room with her kids, sleeping on the floor broke, as in feeding her toddlers with food stamps broke, as in she literally had no idea if she was going to be able to afford rent and whether they would end up homeless. As she said, she also became just really, really depressed. In her own words, she said she found herself sort of obsessed with her own misery, and the only thing that she could think of was to volunteer. She thought, oh, that will make me think about other people. So she called every place in the area that she could think of, homeless shelters, soup kitchens, the children's hospital. She was going to volunteer, and it was going to be her way out of this horrible place that she was in. But there was one problem. She ended up not being able to volunteer because she couldn't afford a babysitter. She would have had to take her two young kids with her. And as she said, no homeless shelter or soup kitchen wants a 2- and a 3-year-old helping. She said, I mean, I get it. They would have done more harm than good. So there she was, finally, with this brilliant idea of how she was going to get out of her misery. And even that had failed. She felt like a loser. One night, she couldn't sleep. she was crying and thinking about her life. So she thought to herself, even when I feel like a complete loser, is there something little, something tiny that I'm good at, that I'm still confident in? And the only thing I could think of is I know how to cook a great meal on very little money. So she sent an email to all of her friends in her area and she said, okay, every Wednesday night, I am going to feed people. If you know anyone who needs a free meal, maybe they're struggling financially, or if you know someone who's lonely, maybe it's an elderly person who just lost their spouse, whatever it is, I don't care. She said, bring them to my apartment on Wednesday nights. I'm going to feed people. So that first Wednesday night rolled around and she went to one of her favorite places, the dollar store, because as she said, when you're poor, the dollar store makes you feel like you're rich. Then she went to the grocery store and she spent some of her food stamps on anything she could find that was on sale. She wasn't trying to follow a recipe. She was just trying to create the biggest meal she could with very little money. Then all these negative thoughts started creeping up again. She started thinking to herself, well, why would anyone show up to your place? Why would your friends bring anyone to you? They'd probably be embarrassed. You're depressed, Christina. Your life is a mess. No one's going to expect you to be able to offer someone something. But 6 o'clock rolled around and slowly people started to come in. Complete strangers started walking into her apartment and letting her feed them. By the end of the night, she'd fed a ton of strangers in her tiny apartment on her tiny little budget with her tiny little kids. She said, I will never forget closing the door after that last person left and just sobbing. But for the first time in a long time, I wasn't sobbing tears of misery and desperation. I was crying like a broken little girl who just experienced her first glimmer of hope and of healing. She went on to say, yes, life was still hard and I was real sad and there were still lots of struggles, but I no longer felt defeated. The next day she got emails from these strangers telling her how much her dinner meant to them. She said, I'm sitting there reading these emails and it hit me like a ton of bricks. Even when I feel like a complete loser, even when my life feels like a crazy, chaotic mess, if I focus on little things that I do have and can do, I can turn it into something bigger than ever expected. She ended by saying, what I've learned from those dinners is that when I shut down that noise and instead focus on the things I already have and the things I can do, that's where I feel peace. And that is where I can fully embrace and enjoy my crazy, awesome life. That, to me, sounds like shalom. Her generosity mattered. It mattered to her. It mattered to the community she served. This is our call too, to take the things we already have and the things we can do and to put them to work for the sake of our neighbor. No matter where we are on the spectrum of have or have not, we can all participate in the holy work of co-creating God's shalom. Your generosity matters. It's stewardship season at Incarnation. As you heard earlier, our theme this year is I'm in. We're asking people to show I'm in by making 3 commitments for our shared work as this community called Incarnation. First, a commitment of financial resources. Second, a commitment to use time and abilities in service. And finally, third, a commitment to pray for the well-being of the people of this community and our work together. My prayer is that each of us lifts our head, takes in the broader view, allows the Spirit of God to expand our view so that together we join in God's work of restoring shalom in our communities and in the world. Are you in?
I don't mind if you've got something nice to say about me, and I enjoy an accolade like the rest. And you could take my picture and hang it in a gallery of all the who's who's and so-and-so's that used to be the best at such and such. It wouldn't matter. This world, I want to leave a legacy. How will they remember me? Did I choose to love? Did I point to you enough to make a mark on things? Want to leave an offering, a child of mercy and grace who blessed your name unapologetically.
For our prayers today, I just want to spend a number of moments being quiet. There's a lot of noise in our world right now. There's a lot of distractions. There's a lot of voices probably pulling you in multiple different directions. I want you to use this as a time to center in on how the Spirit works in our lives. We talk about this at Incarnation in these two ways, that the Spirit invites us into an inward journey, and the inward journey is how we discover who we are as a child of God, how deeply loved we are as God's children. So we'll spend a little time just thinking and praying and reflecting on who we are as children of God. And then the Spirit also calls us out into the world, so that's our outward journey. And then we'll also give you a chance to imagine a little bit who God is calling you to be as you enter this outward journey in this upcoming week. So the inward journey, discovering who we are as a child of God, the outward journey, being sent to be God's people in the world today. Let's pray with one another. Gracious Lord God, Paul reminds us that we are dearly beloved children of God. In the baptism of Jesus, we're reminded that we are marked by love. We are the pride of God's life. In Paul's letter to the Romans, he said, there's nothing ultimately that will ever separate us from God's love in Jesus Christ. Help us to know that at the deepest part of who we are. And in this time, as we consider who we are as children of God, help us to simply be honest about all the ways that we need to understand and experience God's presence more fully in healing ways, in forgiving ways, in hopeful ways. Take this time of quiet to imagine how close the God of the universe is to each one of you. The Spirit of God not only takes us into ourselves where we discover that we are made in the image of God. The Spirit of God then sends us back out into the world to be God's image bearers. And so we pray at this time for all the ways that we will engage this world with God's love and grace and forgiveness and hope in this upcoming week. For all those conflicted places in the world, for those places that need just a word of encouragement, for all those places that need some hope. In this time, we pray for those parts of the world that are most weighing most heavily on our spirits. Gracious and loving Spirit, help us to be able to release those things that keep us from living more fully in your grace and love. And help us to be able to embrace those things that you have desired for us to embrace, a world filled with compassion and justice and kindness and love. Allow us to be those people this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we gather around this meal, we get another opportunity to experience the presence of Christ in simple elements of bread and wine, but most profoundly by being just simply a part of a community where we believe that Christ is present as we receive these gifts, no matter where we are. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Please take a moment and share the bread and wine that you have gathered in front of you and know that Christ is very present. You'll hear the words in your mind, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. And Christ is present in those simple gifts.
Thank you.
As you make your way out into the world today, I want you to go with these words. You matter to God, to us, and to the world. So go in peace, serve the Lord. And together we say, thanks be to God.